Hey guys, what's going on? Kryzarel here, and today we are going to be making items and an inventory in Unity. You might have already seen this UI in the character stats videos. Today we'll be learning how to put it all in place. As you can see, we have our inventory section at the bottom with some items. We can right-click items to equip them, which moves them to the equipment panel up top, and it also has an effect on our stats. We also have tooltips for more details on each item, and on the stats too. Oh, and there's also a link in the description for you guys to download all the UI images. So let's start from scratch by building the UI. We're gonna go through this step by step, so let's start out with the simplest version we can, and we'll keep adding on to it as we go. First, I'm gonna change the camera's color to this gray, because not only am I tired of Unity's default blue, this looks better with our UI anyway. So, we need a canvas, and let's change the scaling mode right off the bat to scale with screen size, and set our reference resolution to 920x1080, and we'll also change the screen match mode to expand. This makes sure the UI always fits in its entirety on screen, although it might end up too small on some aspect ratios. Let's play it safe for now. We can always change it later if there's a setting that looks better. Let's create an empty object that's going to be our character panel and create two images under it. The bottom one will be the inventory and the other will be the equipment panel. Let's set the sprites to... For the equipment panel we want the image called stats and for the inventory we want inventory no text. The images with text are just there to act as references. Let's set both image components to their native sizes. Now we need to adjust the size of the parent object to fit both of these in. For width, we'll look for the largest width of the two child images, and for height, it should be roughly the sum of both children's heights. Position our images correctly by changing their anchors and pivots. We do that by holding down Alt and Shift at the same time. And the equipment panel should be at the top, while the inventory should go to the bottom. We can see there's some space between them, so let's reduce the character panel's height. Now that our anchors and pivots are correct, our images should move as we change their parent's height. We can already see there's a tiny problem here. Our UI is going out of the screen. When working with UI, I like to keep the images at their default size, while also keeping all scales at 1. Because changing scale sometimes has unexpected effects. However, in this case that won't be possible since our images are quite big. There's other ways to fix that, like changing the reference resolution on our canvas scaler, but this time I opted to change the scale of the parent object. Let's also align the equipment panel with the inventory. Now our layout is mostly in place, so we can add the structure for the item slots. Create a new game object as a child of inventory, and add a grid layout group component. Let's call it item slots grid, and change its anchors to stretch, with Alt held down to center it. Create a UI image under it and call it item slot. Now duplicate it by pressing Ctrl D until we have 18 of them. I'm going to cheat a little bit and copy the grid settings from my notes. Okay, now that we have all this, we actually need items and an inventory to do something with it. Let's start by implementing the item class. Once again, we'll start with the simplest possible version and keep adding on to it as needed. Make a scripts folder and create a new C# script called item. Open it up in Visual Studio and delete all the default Unity methods. Our items won't derive from mono behavior. Instead, we'll use a very useful Unity class called ScriptableObject. It works very similarly to mono behaviors, but we can't attach them to game objects. Instead, they live in asset files in our project folders. Let's create two public variables, a string for the item's name and a sprite for the icon. We also need to add a special attribute to the class that only works on scriptable objects. Create asset menu. With this attribute, we can create item assets by right-clicking inside our project tab and selecting the create option. but let's keep this organized by creating a folder just for items. Let's add a name and an icon to our item. But we can't do anything with this yet. We need to implement the inventory. For that, we need two classes, one for the inventory itself, and another for the item slots. For each item slot, we need to store the item that goes into it and a reference to the slot's image component. To access the image class, we need the UnityEngine.ui namespace. Let's add an item slot script to all the item slots we created in our scene just a moment ago. Instead of trying to assign all images manually, let's use some Unity magic to help us out. OnValidate is a special Unity function, just like start and update, that is called at specific times. This one is only called in the editor, and it triggers when the script is loaded or when we change one of its values in the inspector. In our case, if the image component is null, we'll try to find it with getComponent. And now, if we go back to Unity, compiling the code triggers the onValidate function, causing all item slots to find their respective images. Back in the itemSlot class, change the item variable to be a property instead. We'll use the properties setter to update the slot's image. If we assign null, which means the slot is empty, disable the image component. Otherwise, enable it and set its sprite to the items icon. This makes the class really convenient to use. Just change the item and everything updates automatically. Furthermore, our image variable should not be public. We should use the serialize field attribute instead. This allows the variable to remain private or protected, and it still shows up in the inspector. This way, we can't accidentally change it in code. Moving on to the inventory, we need a list of items, a transform for the parent of our item slots, and an array of item slots. Just as we did with the item slot class, we'll use onValidate to make our life easier. If we have our item's parent transform assigned, we can just automatically get all item slots attached to it by calling getComponents in children. Add the inventory script to our inventory game object and drag item slots grid to the item's parent variable. We can see that our item slots have automatically been filled. You might be wondering why we have a list of items when item slots can already contain items. While it's perfectly fine to not use an item list, I feel like it's just easier and cleaner to separate the data from the UI like that, while not having any real downside. But for this to work, we need a way to tie both of them together. Let's make a refresh UI method that we'll call every time a change happens to our inventory. In here, we'll make our item slots match our item list. For every item we have, we'll assign it to an item slot, and for every remaining slot that doesn't have an item to go in it, we'll just set its item to null. Let's make our UI update even if we're not in play mode by calling refreshUI in the onValidate method. In Unity, we should now see all our slots disable their image components. Finally, let's add some items to the items list in the inventory script, and awesome, they show up even when not in play mode. That's all for now, thank you very much for watching, and stay tuned for part 2. See ya!